reasons. Every minute, every moment, where I've been or where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it, there was Jesus. For this man, well, there was Jesus.
There was Jesus.
In the way, in the searching, in the healing of my hurting, like a blessing buried in broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been or where I'm going, even when I couldn't see it. In the shadows of the alleys,
there was Jesus.
In the healing of my heart.
Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome. I know it's a good time to get together and visit and go ahead and find your seats as we kind of warm up here this morning. I'll run a few announcements while everybody else kind of gets ready to go today. We want to thank everybody who participated this weekend in the quilting for the Jamaica evangelism. They are sewing or putting together 30 quilts for people that are dealing with sickle cell anemia. If you know anything about that, it's an anemia that causes people to be very cold. And so even though they're in Jamaica, they need some blankets to stay warm. And the gals have worked a couple different Saturdays to get that done, and they are just about to reach their goal of 30. So thank you to everybody who came this week and helped out and worked hard to make that happen in the last couple weeks. We appreciate that. Secondly, we want to thank everybody who come help us last night with the ice skating for the youth group. Hope that they all had fun. Hope that no one's too sore this morning. I think there's a few people that are kind of gimpy. This happens, right? So appreciate everybody doing that. And also thanks again to everybody who helped us cook gumbo last week and participated in the gumbo cook-off and to help out the kids go to Winterfest. Just a couple things that are on the horizon, then I'll get out of the way this morning. We are doing Families Feeding Families this year, and that's kind of a little project within the church family. There's always people that we know out in the and in our circle outside of the church that are less blessed and less fortunate than we are. And so every year as a church, we kind of offer a partnership with your family and our church family. And what we do is if you know somebody who has a need, the church offers a turkey or a ham, whichever they would prefer, and you and your family can go to the store and grab a few extra groceries that you want to put with that to help them have a great Thanksgiving meal. So if you have somebody that is in need of something, you can get with myself, you can get with McKay, you can get with Miss Julie, and let us know if you would like to take them a ham or a turkey. And then we'll give you an optional shopping list. But a lot of you guys know kind of what that family might like or might need. You can throw a few extra things in there. And then on the Wednesday before, those will be available. You can come and grab them and bring them to them and visit with them. And it just makes a nice opportunity for your family to touch another family during the holiday season. So we're doing that. So if you know of somebody who has such a need, make sure you let us know so we know how many to prepare for and get ready. Secondly, it's getting close to December, which is depressing to me, but it's a reality, right? 2019 is about fini. And Mr. Boo and Mr. Fred want you to know that they are doing the Christmas party for the church. We always have a big get-together on a Saturday night. That will be on the 7th at 6 o'clock. And so if you would like to help out with that, they are more than happy to have your help. They would need your help. So there's a lot of different kinds of jobs, set up and decoration, if that's your thing. They've got set up and decoration to do. There's some cooking that needs to be done, some dishes that need to be washed if you're not a good cook. There's also games to play and things like that. So if you would like to help out with that, they would appreciate that. It's a busy time of year for everybody, so I know they could use a few extra hands. So there's a few other things in your bulletin. We have Bible studies throughout the week that you guys know about. Celebrate Recovery Monday nights. Ladies group meets on Tuesday mornings and Thursday nights. Wednesday night we have our regular services with classes for all ages. So if there's a need, there's an opportunity for you to plug into that, and we would love to help you out if you need to know more about that. We're happy that you guys are here this morning, and we're ready to worship God. I hope that you are as well. So let's all stand up together, and let's praise God.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. And every blessing you pour out, turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, Jesus, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name, blessed be the name.
Thank you. Appear the hour I first
set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. Like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be. As long as life endures, my chains are gone. I've been set. Set free, my God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be
guess it's on, yeah. In Luke 18:10, it reads, Jesus had told this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood up and prayed about himself. God, I thank you that I am not like other men, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, and even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week and give a tenth of all that I get. But the tax collector stood off at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For everyone who exalts himself will be humble, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. The difference is the Pharisee was too busy comparing himself with other people, with others, full of eyes, full of himself, prayed with himself rather than giving God the glory. The Pharisee had nothing to be thankful for. The Pharisee was almost asking God to thank him for being there to give his speech. Very proud, very disturbing, I guess. The Pharisee had everything right but his heart. The tax collector had everything wrong but his heart. The Pharisee made an appearance. The tax collector made a request. The tax collector made full confessions of his sins without excuses or justification, simply mercy. The tax collector wasn't proud because he stood afar off, ashamed, humble. God does not want to know how great we are. He just wants us to be humble. If you go to an AA hospital for help, you have to admit that you are an alcoholic before you can be admitted. This morning, we have to admit that we are sinners and do what the Bible says before we can be admitted into heaven. We are going to take the Lord's Supper this morning. God gave us His only begotten Son for our salvation, for the forgiveness of sins. How are we going to approach God this morning? Are we selfish, self-righteousness, or are we going to be humble? Jesus said it best, "For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted."
Dear Heavenly Father, again, we just thank you for letting us come freely in your house and study your word. God, we just at this time, we just focus on your Son who died on the cross that we could have eternal life. We just pray, God, that as we partake of this bread, which represents his body, and the juice, which represents his blood, that he shed such an awful death for all of us that we could have eternal life. We pray that we remember it. His Son. In Jesus' name, amen.
Don't stand for prayer, if you will. God in heaven, we are thankful for another day of life, the blessings, this beautiful Sunday, in which we can come to this building and worship you with freedom. We pray for all our brothers and sisters throughout the world who are also worshiping today. Be with those who are being persecuted. Give them boldness and courage and strength to stand up for you and preach your gospel. Lord, we pray for our government. We pray for our country. We pray that you'll continue to give us freedom to worship, and that you'll tend to these big problems in politics that we have no power over, essentially. I just pray that you would help it to be conducive to the spread of your gospel. Lord, we pray for those who are sick today. We pray for Miss Jamie James, who has, I believe she has cancer. Pray for Roy So and his family as they're sorrowing. Be with him also as he travels down here. We pray for Byron Rue with his heart trouble. Pray you continue to help him and that he might be feeling better. We pray for all those who have been traveling. Be with the Greens as they're going to be coming back from Italy. We pray for Amy May. We pray for Lauren Runner as she's being deployed. We pray for the Louvier family as they're sorrowing. Pray for Nicole Hanks as she has walking pneumonia. We pray for Arlene Hidalgo family. We pray for Al Roy as he's going to have surgery Tuesday. We pray for Tristan Carvillo as she has RSV. We pray for Bobby Boudreau as he has cancer. We pray for Corey Bro in college. We pray for Troy Menard as he's still in the hospital. We pray for Scene. Can't pronounce that last name, but we pray to be with him with his needs. Pray for Miss Catherine Guidry as she's going to have foot surgery Tuesday. We pray for Jackson Ben Judah as he's not growing, that they can help him. Pray for Linda Trojo as she has surgery this week. We pray for the Woods family as they're helping in Guatemala today. Just watch over us and guide us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let thy goodness so many things in life that we think we've just got to do. Father, we think we've got to get up and we've got to go to work. We've got to pay the bills. We've got to get straight A's in school or maybe C's. Father, we think we've got to get a new vehicle or to live in a certain kind of house or to wear a certain kind of clothing. We've got to have a certain social status. We need to make a certain amount of money. And Lord, I know that you look at all of us and you say, why do you chase after these things? Because you can give us such things that are so much deeper and so much bigger than all the stuff that we chase in this life. Father, I just pray that you would help us to realize that so much of the things that we spend time trying to get here are things that are going to stay here when we leave this place. But the things that you've offered to us, Lord, are the kinds of things that not only make this life a peaceful and beautiful one, but they're the things, Lord, that will follow us from this life throughout all eternity. Father, help us to be thankful for those things that you have laid in our life, the people that you have allowed us to be a part of their lives, Lord. God, help us to be thankful for the word that you gave us to teach us who you are and what it is that you want for us to do in the life that you've given us. And we thank you mostly, Lord, for Jesus, for his willingness to come and show us how to live, to be our Savior, even in the midst of our brokenness. I just pray, Lord, this morning as we open your word, that you might open our hearts to what it is you have to say to us personally. That, Lord, we might learn what it means to be the kind of people that you've called us to be a little bit more today. We thank you, Lord, that we're able to be here. Open our hearts to what you have to say to us, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So there's a funny story about a man named Henry. And Henry lay in a darkened hospital room, a menagerie of hoses and wires coming from his body. He was in the final hours of his life, and he looks over to his dear wife, who was faithfully sitting by his side. He says, Ethel, you remember when we were first married and our house caught fire, and we were standing there in the front yard, everything that we owned going up in flames? You were right there with me. She said, yeah. Yeah, I sure was, Henry. Ethel, you remember a few years later when I lost my job and we went about a whole year and we didn't have any money coming in, and boy, that was tough. But you were right there. And she said, yeah. Henry, I sure do remember that. You remember when we were going to retire after the kids got out of school, but then the stock market crashed and we didn't have much retirement savings, so we had to work another 10 years, but you were right there. And she said, yes, Henry, I was. And she lovingly reached out and took a hold of his hand. And he said, here I am in this hospital and I'm about to die, and here you are right beside me. She said, yes, Henry, I'm right here. 55 years I've been right here. He said, you know, it just occurred to me, Ethel, you're nothing but bad luck. Yeah, so much for sentiment, huh? We just flushed that one down the toilet this morning. Yeah. You know, it's funny, but there's people that are like that. Truth of the matter is that sometimes I'm like that. Sometimes maybe you're like that. So much of life is about the lens with which we look at it. And so often I choose, well, an ungrateful, negative lens. I'm a blessed person. If you know my life story, you know that God has been very good to me. And as I look around this room this morning, I see a room full of people who God has also been very good to. Think about it just with me for a moment this morning before we jump into our lesson. Imagine how beautiful a thing it is that we possess that many others in the world don't. For one thing, we were born in America, and I know I remind you of this a lot, but I just think it's so important that we are cognizant of how truly physically blessed we are as a people. If you've never been out of the United States of America and you have the opportunity to go, I I encourage you to do that just so you can see how a lot of the other world lives. Guys, we are so materially blessed. But as I look around the room this morning, I see a lot of people in this room this morning that have been blessed in other ways as well. We've been blessed with relationships. Relationships with family and friends within the church body. Sometimes there are generations of relationships. Many of those have already gone on to be with the Lord, and yet their life and their legacy remains as a part of our story. And we are blessed because we knew them and were able to be with them and be a part of who they were. We are blessed people. As I look around the room this morning, I also recognize that for the majority of us, we have made a decision. A decision that we really had no right to make. A decision that in reality, if everything was fair in the world, God would have never given us this decision because we made it in our ignorance and in our rebellion when we chose to walk away from God. But God, in His mercy and grace, gave us an opportunity to come back into the family of God, to have our sins washed away in the waters of baptism, to rise and to walk in brand new life. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, we are blessed people. And yet so often, guys, we're miserably ungrateful. We're going to talk this morning about how to be ungrateful. In case you don't know this morning, in case you missed out on that lesson, in case somewhere in the world the human nature didn't really settle with you, we're going to talk this morning about how is it that we're ungrateful. And then in the end, we're going to talk about how we combat that, because quite frankly, none of us want to be a Henry. We want to be that person that recognizes that we are blessed and to live in that blessing. The Apostle Paul wrote these words to the Philippian church. He says, "Do all things without grumbling or disputing, that you may be blameless and innocent children of God without blemish in the midst of this crooked and twisted generation among whom you shine as lights in the world." Now, let me just pause for a moment, and we're going to kind of pull some of this apart. But look, we live in a world that is as equally twisted and broken as the one to whom Paul was writing this letter. When I read those words this week, as I chose this text, I said, yeah, we still have a crooked and twisted generation. And we wonder, as the church, how is it that we make a difference in a world that is so full of noise that's pushing people in other directions? I mean, think about it for a moment if you can. The Apostle Paul was not dealing with the world that we're dealing with. The Apostle Paul did not have Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and Snapchat. The Apostle Paul was not writing to a Philippian church that was dealing with the evils of the internet and the poison of the internet. He wasn't dealing with a world where they had mass communication and mass indoctrination. We have that world today. If the Apostle Paul's world was noisy and twisted and crooked, our world is ever as much or even more so. What would be God's advice on how to make an impact in such a difficult scenario? The Apostle Paul gives it to us right here. One of the things that you learn in marketing, if you've ever taken a marketing class, is you learn that you have to cut through the noise. Almost everybody in the world around us, brothers and sisters, today, there's just this noise level. If you've ever played with ham radios, Bruce and I kind of like ham radios a little bit, right there in Benji, and I think there's a few more of us nerds in the room here this morning. But if you're ever on a ham radio, and there's certain times of the year where it's just noisy, right? And there's certain guys that they have a certain tuning on their radio or a certain antenna, and the point of that is to cut through the noise. How do we cut through the noise? How do we cut through the clutter of the world? Well, Paul gives us an excellent way to do so right here. He said, do everything, all things. I don't like that word, but that's what he said. Do all things without grumbling and complaining or disputing, that you may be blameless and innocent children of God without blemish in the midst of this crooked generation. And then he says, among whom you will shine like stars or lights in the world. So we're going to pull this apart this morning and this subject apart this morning. But let's start off having a little fun. How can you be ungrateful? Like, suppose this morning that if someone were to come up to you and say, I need some creative ideas on how to be ungrateful. Now, don't take me seriously on this part of it this morning. I do not want you to be ungrateful. We just talked about that. But let's just play devil's advocate this morning for a moment. How is it that you could be the most ungrateful that you can be? How can you achieve a high degree of success in the ungrateful category? Well, number one, I think it's a great idea for you to keep a journal. Now, not a journal of blessings. That would be completely off limits. We're talking about a journal of everything that somebody ever said or did against you in life. Now, you want to keep a journal. It's very important because you want to be able to remember every one of those things. You wouldn't want to forget what someone said in 1963 about you if you were alive then. So make sure you have that journal and then look through that often. All right, that's very important to review the offenses so that you can be reanimated and re-angered every time that you read through it. So number one, keep a journal of all the things that someone did against you because that will help you not find any light or good in a given day. Number two, use negative words whenever you can. Now, you can use positive words or negative words in the world, but if you want to be a truly ungrateful person, then you need to make sure that you use as many negative words as possible, especially when posting on social media. This is very important, all right? So use words like these words, for instance. Use words like horrible and bad and atrocious. Atrocious is a great word. If you don't know how to spell it, I'll give you that spelling later. Call people stupid and ignorant. This is very good for creating a negative vibe that you want to have if you want to be an ungrateful person. All right, so number three, be constantly distracted. If you ever really pay attention to how well you have it in life, this will destroy your ability to be ungrateful. Like if you actually contemplate how that you have a good meal in front of you, or that you have friends and family that still, for some reason, can put up with you, you're going to lose all of your ungrateful edge. So make certain that you're constantly distracted by negative influences. You can find them a million places. Don't have to work too hard for that. The devil provides them by a plentiful. Just make sure that you're constantly distracted. So just to review, make sure you keep a journal and review every negative thing that anyone ever did against you. Number two, use negative words whenever you can. Number three, be constantly distracted. Number four, focus only on yourself when you pray. And we all know we're supposed to pray because God said we should. But just pray for yourself. Don't bother to pray for anybody else because here's this dangerous thing that happens. When you start to pray for other people, heavens forbid that you pray for your enemy. When you start to pray for other people, you just naturally begin to see the world through their eyes. And that erodes all the ungratefulness that you can muster. So make certain that you only pray for your needs. And if you want a great example of this, Lewis provided us a wonderful example of a man who did a wonderful job of this in the Bible. So you can even have a Bible image of this, the Pharisee who prayed in the temple. He did a wonderful job of exactly what we're talking about. Number five, just make sure that your pride is in complete control of your life. Now, you want to be an absolutely miserable, hateful, awful, and ineffectual Christian. Try those five things on that list. You and I were smiling around the room this morning, right? Partially because we're having fun, and partially because we all know and we have all done a lot of things on that list. If you want to be a person that's not ungrateful, here's my suggestion. Take that list of five things and flip it around. Take your journal of offenses and burn it. And write instead a journal of all the good that people have done for you in your life. The kindness that people extend in a day. Listen, guys, you have an equal opportunity. I'm horrible for this. If somebody cuts me off in traffic, I remember that all day long. How many of you are like that? Chaps your eye when people cut you off in traffic. How many of you remember the person that stops and lets you out at Sonic during lunch hour? All right? I'm just like, hey, thanks, I wave. I don't let that shade my day with colors of brightness. No. I'm just like, well, at least there's one good person in the world, right? Yeah. Come on, we don't have to remember all the people that cut us off. That's an option. Think about the people who didn't. All right, number two, negative words are important. There's a time for them. But you can use positive words too. In fact, positive words typically have a lot more of a motivational effect on people than negative ones. Be constantly focused, not distracted. Guys, listen to me. This is really a secret. If you pay attention to what God has done for you, you'll be blown away. God works in the smallest of things. And sometimes I'm out here looking up here at the big thing. I'm 15 miles down the road where God has done just a beautiful thing right in front of me. I tripped over it. I didn't even see it. Sometimes I wasn't even grateful for it. I hate this about myself, but so often I'll go to God in prayer and I will pray, God, please deal with this situation. Please handle something. God, this is over my head. And you know how God works. He doesn't do it like in 30 seconds, right? So it happens like a week later, but a month or two later, I wake up and realize God answered my prayer. I hate that about myself. Why can't I notice it in a moment? Well, because sometimes I'm distracted with all other kinds of stuff and I'm not looking and watching where God is working right now. Guys, we got to focus on ourselves when we pray. I get that. If you're Jason Corder, you have a lot to pray in repentance for, and you need a lot of help. But guys, there's a whole lot of other people out there to pray for as well. You'll find this beautiful thing happens when you pray for people, even people you don't like, even people who are your enemies, even people who are hurting you, or have hurt you, you will find that God begins to work in the midst of those situations to change your heart. And that's what prayer is all about. As Mr. Lewis set us up so well this morning, be humble. Pride will destroy every bit of gratitude in your life. I liked what Mr. Lewis said. I don't know if you noticed that, but he said that Pharisee is praying almost like God should thank him. Listen, there isn't one of us in this room this morning that is God's gift to the church. There's not one of us in this room this morning that the world could not exist without us. If there is good within us, it is only because God loves us enough to allow us to have life long enough to fix the brokenness and to blend our lives into the pattern of his son. We would not even know what goodness was if we did not have Jesus. Human beings are not naturally good people. We learn how to be good. We learn how to become Christ-like. And it's written kind of within our hearts. Guys, we are blessed people. And we should recognize that. So how do we cultivate a grateful heart? Let's spend some time this morning and take a look at a couple things. Certainly, you could preach for an entire month on how to be grateful. I just wanted to look at two things this morning quickly of how do we cultivate a grateful heart. The first thing is simply this. I think this is really important. You might say, well, this is a negative, Jason. It is. But sometimes we need to understand God's attitude towards our attitudes so we can fix ours. Sometimes I need a little kick in the seat of the pants, a little motivation. And I think we need to recognize that God hates ingratitude. There's a massive story that fills up a vast majority of the Old Testament. It's found in the book of Exodus. You guys know it, most of you well. If you've never read through the book of Exodus, you should. It's a story of God dealing with his people. After Joseph had died, the children of Israel remained in the land of Goshen. They would remain there for a long time. In fact, for 400 years, they would just grow and multiply. But they soon became controlled by the Pharaoh. They were no longer there as guests. They were now there as slaves. And God sets up Moses to be in a perfect place to let God's people go. And we'll never know in this side of earth, and maybe not when we get to heaven. We may not have a right to ask that question. But I always wonder if the plan that we read in Exodus was really God's plan B, because he had kind of maybe put Moses in a place to just do it without all the plagues and the shenanigans. But Moses made a decision. For 40 years, Moses was a shepherd in the wilderness. And 80 years of age, God says, Moses, I want you to come. I want you to go to Pharaoh, and I want you to let my people go. And you know the story, right? You know, eventually there's 10 plagues and the people leave after the final plague and they cross over the Red Sea and there's this great victory. But then you begin to get an image of the personality of these people that we have just called the children of Israel. And you start to see that they are the most whiny, complaining group of people that you might ever imagine. As you read through the story, I mean, immediately, As soon as they are rescued out of the land of Egypt, they get to the Red Sea. The army's coming. You brought us out here to die. I mean, every moment of every turn, we're going to die, right? At one point, they are so reminiscent for Egypt, which was their land of slavery, that they're saying, why couldn't we just go back to Egypt because they had leeks and onions? Now, how many of you like onions here today? How many of you would rather live a life with onions in slavery? Or how many of you would rather just give up onions and be free? I mean, yeah, me too, James. But yet these people are just complaining and they're whining. In fact, in Numbers, the 11th chapter, is kind of this culmination of a moment. Numbers 11, in verse number 1, it says the people complained about their hardships. And you guys, you should know that these people have seen some amazing things. They had seen the Red Sea parted. They had seen the Amalekites defeated. They had spent a year encamped around Mount Sinai, where they had seen the presence of God erupt on the top of the mountain. They had received God's covenant. They are now ready to move into the promised land. That's where we are here in Numbers, the 11th chapter. But the people are complaining. This is an 11-day journey, guys, just for mental purposes. 11-day journey from Mount Sinai to Kadesh Barnea, which would be the entry point into the promised land. 11 days. They have waited 400 years for this moment. They are 11 days away. And the people complained about their hardships in the hearing of the Lord. When he heard them, his anger was aroused. Then fire from the Lord burned among them and consumed some of the outskirts of the camp. And when the people cried out to Moses, he prayed to the Lord, and the fire died down. So the place was called Tamra because fire from the Lord had burned among them. And you might be like, oh, good, they caught on. Quit being a bunch of whiny, complaining, fussy, ungrateful people. But no, if you're reading in Numbers 11, you find out down in verse 10, Moses heard the people of every family wailing at the entrance to their tents. Any guesses as to why they're wailing? I know it's a sermon, but you can speak up if you know this. They want meat. Right? Every morning, every night when the dew settles, manna fell from heaven. Literally food just appeared on the ground, and they would go out and they would harvest it. And they had made all kind of recipes. This has sustained their life for a lengthy period of time. They have just seen God burn the outskirts of their camp because they're whining. And in a few verses later, they're crying again, wailing, as the Bible puts it, at the entrance of their tents, every family, because they want meat. And the Lord became exceedingly angry. And I love this. And it said, and Moses was troubled. And he asked the Lord, why have you brought this trouble on your servant? What have I done to displease you that you put this burden of these people on me? If you've ever led people, you know exactly how Moses feels in this moment, right? Lord, what did I do to have to put up with this million plus whiny babies right here, right? But if you know the rest of the story, you know that that group of people will walk up to the entrance of the promised land. They will send 12 spies into the promised land. They will see that it is a wonderful place. 10 of them will come back and say, we can't do it. 2 of them said, we can. Let me just shorten up the entirety of this story for you very, very succinctly. Of those 12 spies and of those millions of people, we're told that there could be upwards of a million people in that group. There's but a handful of that generation that will walk across the boundary into the promised land. Moses, he will die on the mountain before he goes. His accompanier, Joshua, and his friend Caleb. The two guys that came back from that and said, look, it is a big land. It is a wonderful place. There are giants in that land, but we serve a Lord that is bigger than them. Two guys that understood what it meant to trust God. Those two guys will go back across. Everyone else will die in a 40-year wandering pattern in the wilderness. Guys, they were 11 days away from victory, and they spent the next 40 years dying off because they were ungrateful. Please just harness this for me this morning. God hates complaining and ungratefulness, especially when we're complaining with our mouth full. And guys, if you're an American, we're complaining with our mouth full, let's be honest. We've got to, secondly, change our perspective. Most of us fit everything in life into two categories, just natural. I do it, you do it, we probably all do it. The things that we're thankful for. This time of year, people, in fact, tell you, why don't you list out the things you're thankful for, right? And that's great advice. What are the things in life that you are thankful for? But if you have a list of things that you're thankful for, there's also another list that develops, right? And that is a list of the things that you are not thankful for. Now, I'll bet you this morning that if I were to ask you, hey, why don't you make me a list of things you're thankful for and things you're not thankful for? You know, truthfully, for most of us, if we're just honest, probably the list of things we're thankful for would be, you know, medium-sized sheet of paper. The list of things that we're not thankful for would probably cover two notebooks, right? I mean, because that's just how we are sometimes. But God challenges us to do something very different. God challenges us to get rid of one of those notebooks. And it's not the thankful one. It's the unthankful one. I'll never forget a sermon. I believe it was my good friend Josh Smith. Josh used to be here and preach here. And he preached a sermon one time. And I remember him preaching it because I remember this text just burnt a hole in my heart. And for the longest time, I struggled with this text. And Josh did a good job of preaching it, obviously, because I can remember it. And it was a long time ago. 1 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter. And verse 18, Paul writes this. He says, rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. We'll read that again, and then we're going to pull it apart quickly this morning. He says, rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances. Okay, to be honest with you, I can kind of wrap my mind around rejoice always. Although it's very difficult for me to fathom that. How am I going to find joy in certain occasions? It's difficult to do that. It doesn't mean that we're always jumping up and down with joy, but I think it means that rather we are people that are okay with the world and okay with things that happen to us because we know that we have the Spirit of God living within us, that we are on a part of the family of God, that we've made peace with our eternal Father, and that if this life ends right now, that we have something better that's waiting for us. And guys, that hope the Bible talks about is a powerful motivator, and I hope that's a part of every single one of your story this morning. And if it's not, let's get together and let's talk about that, because all of us, God has given us the opportunity to have a solid hope. That's what God wants for us. Let's make sure that we have that. And then he says, pray without ceasing. And you know, of course, that's always a combat point too, right? Like, how am I going to do my life and pray? But I think really what Paul's just meaning here is that we are to be constantly connected with God. Every moment of every day, we should be in this kind of relationship with him because we receive at baptism the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, right? The Holy Spirit is a part of the Godhead. And so in real sense, when Jesus said, I'm about to take off, and the disciples were like, please, no, don't take off. And he said, it's good that I leave because when I leave, the Helper comes. And Jesus was excited about the fact that the Helper came because Jesus knew that he could only have an individual, personal relationship with the people that he was physically around, the 12. But the Holy Spirit had the ability to have that personal relationship with everybody who would prepare their life and have their sins washed away to be filled with that Spirit. And so Jesus is like, this is a good thing. Let the Spirit come. And we have an opportunity to walk and to live every moment of every day in a relationship, in a communication with God. I think that's what Paul is trying to say right there when he says, pray without ceasing. And then he says, give thanks in all circumstances. And this is the easiest one to understand. I mean, there's no working around this. It's pretty clear. Give thanks. We know what that means. All circumstances. You don't even have to know the Greek to understand what he's saying right here. But yai, this is hard to live out. We're in a Thanksgiving season. And it's the time of year that we see people sharing things that they're grateful for all over the place. And I love that. I think that's wonderful. If you're doing that, you keep that up, because that is the kind of thing that we should be doing as Christians, not just this time of year, but all year round. And the thing is, I love it. It's inspiring, but for a lot of people, it doesn't really even outlast this holiday season. Paul wasn't talking about seasonal gratitude. He was talking about a state of mind that starts with our trust in God and our belief that God works all things out for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. If you read through Romans 8:28, it's exactly what that text says. Now guys, let me tell you, this is a hard thing to do. And I'm not good at it. And I just told you, I heard a sermon about this years ago, and I've had to work on it. But here's a couple things that we should notice at the end of this text. It says, give thanks in all circumstances because it's God's will for us. It's what God wants. God does not want for us to be ungrateful people. God's desire for us is that we look and find the good in all the things that happen in our life. God has the ability to do what we cannot do. He can bring out good even in the midst of evil. He can turn around the stupid mistakes that we've made and cause it to have some good effect in this life. No matter what happens, God is never going to stop loving us. And there's 100 things to be thankful for in every circumstance, but we've got to change our focus point. So often I'm focusing on the bad. These are the negative things. This is the thing that shouldn't be happening. And often we're right. But God said there's a whole lot of other things that could be focused on as well. The second thing I want you to notice about this is that when we practice what I like to call radical gratitude, because this is pretty radical, when you're giving thanks in all things, imagine you go to the doctor and you receive a diagnosis that there's something very wrong with you. It's very hard in that moment, if it's you or if it's a loved one, to be grateful, right? It's very, very hard to when you're going through a very difficult financial season in life to look around and be thankful if you've lost your job or if the car just the transmission just fell out of the bottom of the car or whatever the case might be. It is hard in those moments to be thankful in all circumstances. But radical gratitude creates something that we all really want. It creates deep relationships. A deep relationship with God, and a deep relationship with people who are around us. Revelation, the second chapter, Jesus is auditing the churches scattered throughout Asia, and he's talking to John, and he's saying, John, tell these different churches different things. And he comes to the church in Ephesus, and at the beginning, he has a glowing review of this church. They're doing many, many things right. And then he says in the middle of that, but I have this against you, in verse number three or four there, he said, I have this against you. You have lost your first love. Consider the height from which you have fallen. Repent and do the works, do the things that you did at first. You think about that when you were young and in love. What's one of those motions, those things that, if you're now old and not in love, that's what I'm inferring. No, I'm just picking right here, right? But if you've lost your first love, what is one of the things that just kind of is a moniker of a new love? Was this fascination, right? And it's this kind of appreciation for somebody. You think about this if you're a guy or gal. When you first met the person that you really, really loved and you admired, and if it was a guy, you admired his big muscles and his bald head, his locks of beautiful hair. And if it was a girl, you admire the beauty of her blue eyes, right? And how soft her hand was. And then there's something that just happens. You eventually say, you know what, we want to spend the rest of our life together, right? And so you get married, and then every morning you wake up and his frock of beautiful hair is like a shrubbery, and her blue eyes are all full of sleep, right? And all the kind of the new wears off of it, and you're just used to it, and you don't notice the beauty that's still a part of your life because you get comfortable with it. When we practice radical gratitude, guys, it forces us to look at the little things and be thankful for them. Henry was not very thankful that his wife had been uber faithful throughout a lifetime of difficult seasons. And sometimes we can be a lot like him. So if you're moved away from your husband or your wife this morning, I know this isn't a sermon about that, but you know what, guys? I find working with couples that are having marriage problems, one of the biggest reasons why things aren't working is simple lack of gratitude. He doesn't appreciate that she came home from work and cooked a meal that maybe didn't turn out quite up to expectations of hers or his. She doesn't appreciate the fact that he had a long day at work. He's exhausted and tired, and he doesn't have the energy that he used to have when he comes home from work. We're not being grateful for what the person is and what they're doing. We're focusing on the things that they aren't. So express that gratitude. Write little notes of kindness and encouragement. Make a call or text during the day and just tell them that you're thankful for something that they're doing. This week I had somebody just call me up one afternoon and just say, hey, just want to thank you for something. And it was kind of a rough, nasty sort of day. Sometimes we all have those, right? That's a bright spot in a rough, nasty sort of day. It doesn't take any effort to do that. It just takes some focus and some intentionality on our part. Sometimes the reason we've lost that loving feeling is because we've stopped doing what it was that we did. And that's not just with our spouse or with our employer. That's with our Heavenly Father. Don't just go to Bible or to services on Sunday morning or Bible study. If you want to develop a relationship with the people in your church family, get in part of their lives. Text them during the week. Ask them, how can I pray for you? How can I be a part of your life? I appreciate you being a faithful follower of Christ in Crowley. I need you to be a part of this team that we call church family. How can I help you grow in that way? There's one other thing we've got to talk about as we close this morning, and that is the difference between constructive criticism and destructive critique. Because you can't just go through life and never say anything negative. You can't just go through life and never point out when things aren't working. And it's not ingratitude when we notice that things could be better or that they need to change. When I was a kid, I grew up, I was a part of a youth organization that had this as their motto: we make the best better. We look for ways to improve even what is already good. And if that's good enough for a youth organization, certainly that should be the mindset for the church, right? Because we aren't just serving some kind of a subpar being. We are serving the one who created the world that we live in. We are serving the one that created everything that we know. We are serving the one that gave his son so that we might have salvation. Guys, that's pretty huge. That should motivate us. But the truth is that sometimes we don't say things that we should, and we say things that we ought not. Ephesians, the fourth chapter, verse number 29, it gives a little bit of a guideline for this, if you will. It says, let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for building up, as fits the occasion, that it might give grace to those who hear. So Paul, talking to the church in Ephesus, he challenges them to do something that is really, really difficult. And part of the reason why we're not good at this as people, I'm not good at this, maybe you aren't either, is that this is a real challenge. It requires that we think about what we say. It requires that we take a bold stance sometimes, even when we would rather maybe ignore a situation. It requires that we step out of a comfort zone and address issues that maybe we would rather ignore, but it's absolutely essential. He said, don't let any corrupting talk come from your mouth. We don't have time to blow this all the way open this morning. Let me just tell you that there's two kinds of conversation in life. There's a kind of conversation that builds up, that fixes problems, that provides resolutions. And then there's a kind of conversation in life that tears down and spreads gossip. And both of those are an option for every single one of us every single day. Constructive criticism is designed, and it's the kind of talk that, as he calls it here, building up as fits the occasion and gives grace. That kind of conversation, we call that constructive criticism, is meant to help somebody grow and become more like Jesus. All right, and if somebody comes up to you and says, look, I want to challenge you in this area, not because I enjoy this, but because I really think that maybe you need to take a look at this area in your life. If somebody's coming up to you, by all means, entertain that thing. Even if they don't say it right to you guys, we want to become better people. Constructive criticism is not always positive. I've had a lot of people come up to me and say some negative things before, but I knew that in their heart they were trying to help me to become a better preacher, help me to become a better leader, a better father, a better husband, and I appreciated that. You know when somebody's looking out for you. Critic is almost always giving their critique based on their personal and biblical experience. not just what they think, but what they know to be true. Constructive criticism is educational. It gives us an understanding of why it's related to the issue at hand. It's not just a you're dumb kind of thing, which sometimes we can do that, but it helps that person to build and to grow. Destructive criticism is typically that kind of thing that we just do kind of offhandedly. To be honest with you, destructive criticism is that thing that just comes natural for us, where we point out weaknesses in others and drive them down, where we repeat things that we hear from behind the scenes, not with an intention for good, but with an intention to make other people look less than. A lot like that man that Lewis introduced to us this morning, who stood in the temple, and he looks across the temple at a man who is obviously a sinner, and says, "And God, I thank you that I am not like that tax collector." Guys, that man needed to change. By his own admission, he recognized he had faults. What he needed in that moment was not somebody to stand across the temple and loudly announce his sinful behavior. What he needed was for a more godly person to come over and extend an arm around the shoulder and say, "Listen, tax collector, let you and I talk about what it means to be honest and ethical. Let's talk about what it means to make amends. Let's talk what it means to follow God and to live our lives for God's glory." That's what that man needed in that moment. Not an announcement of his sin, but somebody that would pull him in and make him stronger. Guys, it's so easy for us to fall into a pattern of complaining. We complain about others, complain about the weather. I'm bad for that, as if it's going to change because I don't like it. We complain about our husbands and our wives. We complain about our kids, our employers. We complain about the car that we drive to church in perfectly climate-controlled comfort. We complain about our church family. And God hates it. Several weeks ago, I don't know if you guys were here, and if you weren't, you missed a good communion meditation. Bruce shared with us a communion meditation that caused us to reflect on how somebody responded to the world that we live in. He said, "You ever thought about how Jesus looked at the world? Even the best meal that Jesus ever ate was subpar to the least in heaven. Any communication or meaningful conversation that Jesus could ever have with anyone in this world, no matter how wise or smart, look, he is teaching the wisest and the smartest at the age of 12 in the temple. Jesus had long since eclipsed their intellectuality on this given plane, but he still loved people. Jesus was one who created the world, and yet he walked about in dusty sandals. He was the one who was soon to die for the apostles, but he stooped to wash their filthy feet." In Isaiah, the 53rd chapter, there's this beautiful passage that just reminds us of the greatness of who Jesus was in a poetic form. I love this passage because it's written long before Jesus ever came, and it's one of those powerful proof texts to me of the authenticity of Scripture and the reality of who Jesus was and God's plan. It's talking here, obviously, about Jesus in Isaiah 53, and it says, "He was oppressed and afflicted." If you look at every corner of Jesus' life, it was nothing but heartache. If you've come to church this morning, you're like, "Jason, you don't understand where I came from. You don't understand what happened in my week this week. You don't understand the struggles that I go through." You're right, I don't. I'm not in your shoes. And I fully understand that maybe some of us have had a terrible week this week. Maybe some of us have had an amazing week this week. Maybe some of us have run into challenges that are bigger than us. And maybe some of us have just had one of those kind of weeks where you just sailed through and it's a Sunday already and you're like, "Wow, God, thank you for that." Let me tell you something. There's nobody in this world who's ever lived that understands more about affliction and oppression than Jesus. He wasn't just oppressed by the people that he lived in this world with, but he had to deal with the full power and strength of Satan himself. I'm 100% confident that I've never been someplace that Satan himself showed up to tempt me. Jesus did. He said he was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep is before the shears silent, he didn't open his mouth. know, sometimes we say something like, well, I have a right to say what I think. No, you don't. Because the one that paid the price for your life kept his mouth quiet. Now, if what you have to say is to build up and to encourage, if what you have to say is to steer somebody that's walking towards the path of sin away from death and hell and separation from God, then by all means, you must say what needs to be said. But if what you are saying is simply so that you can feel better about yourself or the situation, or you can spread a bit of gossip, if what you're saying is simply because you would like to vent some of your own personal frustration or anger about a situation, guys, Jesus set us an example that didn't look like that. You think of all the things Jesus could have complained about. That list is a long one. As far as I can tell, he really almost complained not at all. The only thing that you could even say is a complaint with Jesus is he said, I'm thirsty. And they gave him wine vinegar and he refused it. It's the closest thing that you can find to Jesus complaining in the Bible. And he's dying on a cross. Now, he spoke a lot to people who were sinful and broken. So guys, it's easy to be ungrateful, isn't it? I'm good at it. How about you? We need to start being really bad at it. God has called us to take a step up, to be a person and a group of people that shine like stars in a universe, that aren't complaining and grumbling like the children of Israel did, but are people who go into the world and say, thank you, God, for what it is you've done for me this day, to find hope in places where no one else finds hope, to find gratitude in places where everyone says God has left this situation. Because when we do that, people are going to look at us and say, there's something wrong with you, and I want some of that. And that's exactly how we rise above the noise and make a difference for God. We're going to stand together and we're going to sing this morning as we close. If you have a need this morning, you guys know that you always can come. If you have a desire to talk about something in your life that's going on, Bruce and Jody are right up front. McKay is around here over on the side. I'll visit with you. I'll be happy to pull you aside and visit in confidence if that's what you need. This morning, we just don't want you to leave this place not make peace with your God. Let's sing together. My chains.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, his mercy rains, unending love, amazing.
Father in heaven, Lord, we just thank you that our chains have been broken. We pray for those, Lord, here today and other places today who are still in bondage, who have not taken an opportunity that you've given them to confess their sins, to come clean with you and with other people that they can find hope and healing. God, I just pray you give them the courage to do that. for those of us, Lord, who know how sweet that forgiveness and that freedom tastes because we've experienced it, God, we thank you. Help us to remember, God, how blessed we are to be a part of your family. When those moments in life come up where we are tempted to focus on the negatives of them, help us to have strength from your Spirit to see the good that you're doing in the midst of this brokenness. Help us to never be like that Pharisee whose eyes were blinded by his own pride and arrogance so much so that he didn't recognize that he, as all of us, are a sinner that is in need of your grace. We thank you, Father, that you love us, that you made a way for us to be a part of your family and to be right with you. We just ask that, Father, you would forgive us for our ungratefulness and for our complaints in all of your goodness. Help us, Lord, to develop a heart of gratitude and appreciate what it is you've done for us. We ask you to be with us this week, Lord, as we leave this place and we head out to our homes, whether they be near or far, that you would give us safety as we travel there, that you would help us to be a bright light in a dark world, and that the world could see Jesus because of us. We ask all these things in your Son's name. Amen.